Africa Inland Church, Milimani, Nairobi. We are a biblically mature community of believers worshiping and serving Christ. We exist to glorify God by connecting people to Christ and His family, helping them to discover their life mission and positively impact our world. Guided by five biblical pillars, namely worship, ministry, evangelism, fellowship, and discipleship, we are dedicated to honor God in worship, sharing the good news of Christ, intentional discipleship, and sound biblical teaching, as well as excellence in our service to God and humanity. Led by the Reverend Dr. Stephen Mairori, we have a team of seasoned and dedicated ministers, Reverend Matthew Okeo, Reverend Sylvester Kirwa, Pastor Rachel Kisula, Reverend Luke Odhiambo, Reverend Stephen Munyambu, and Reverend Hosea Mitei. We are anchored on the rock of ages and geared to the times to minister the love of Christ to a hearting global community. We are AIC Milimani Nairobi. We are dedicated to reach you online, on radio, and on TV. Welcome to this online broadcast. The King bless you. Bless you.
Good morning, church. Welcome to our online service this morning. We are glad that you could join us this Sunday, 26th of July, 2020. This is AIC Milimani, Nairobi. We are also live on Truth FM 90.7. My name is Pastor Rachel Kisula, and we are going to begin with a word of prayer. Let us pray. Our Lord and Father, we are grateful. We worship you, we adore you, we lift your name for the opportunity that you've given us to come and worship. And Lord, we now want to invite your presence, that you will begin with us, that you will walk with us, that we will feel the warmth of fellowshipping with you. And the Lord, whatever we do in this service, will glorify your name. And so we pray that you may lead us. We invite the presence of the Holy Spirit, and we pray that you can be with us and bless each member who is watching. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And I want to invite the worship team to lead us in worship. Welcome, worship team.
Good morning, church. We welcome you to this service this day, and we pray that you are blessed and well kept all this long. While you're back at home, we just want you to just rise up, stand up, move around your house, and just worship with us as we sing through this music. Before we start, we just want to welcome the Holy Spirit with a word of prayer. So may we all just close our eyes wherever we are. King of Kings, we just want to raise you this day. We want to praise you this morning, King of Kings. We thank you, Jehovah, for the gift of life, for the protection you have given us, O God, throughout this season of Corona, Jehovah. You have kept us safe. You have protected our family and friends. You have kept Kenya, Lord, alive. We thank you, O God, for your favor, your mercy, and your grace, O Lord. And we know that you are the creator of the universe. And for this, oh God, we just want to be humble before your presence, to bow before your presence, and to glorify. Just glorify your holy name, King of Kings. Be exalted, oh God, and receive all the glory and all the honor. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. So now we sing a very simple song together. So just put your hands together. Come on.
Creator, creator of the universe.
love you, Lord. Oh, we bless your holy name. We love you, Jesus. We adore your holy name, Lord. For there is no one else like you. Father in heaven, how we love you. We lift your name in all the earth. May your kingdom be established in our praises. As your people, we declare your mighty words. Oh, Father in heaven, how we love you. We lift your name in all the earth. May your kingdom be established in our praises. As your people, we declare your mighty works. Sing with me, Father in heaven.
Lord,
blessed be the Lord.
God, God.
utukufu twakupa. Twakuabudu wewe,
twakuabudu
wewe peke yako. Twakuabudu.
Majeshi
Thank you so much, Mabalozi Choir, for blessing us this morning. And as we continue worshiping together, let us bow for a word of prayer. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you. We thank you so much for life given to us. We thank you for an opportunity to be called the children of God. We thank you for a fellowship that we have with you. We thank you that the Lord Jesus Christ died on the cross for the forgiveness of our sins, and now we are called children of God. And thank you that we can come to your presence even to present to you our needs. We commit ourselves to you this morning, praying for your divine wisdom and guidance. As we fellowship together in this service, Lord, may you bless us. May you reach out to those who are going through challenging situations in their lives. There are people who are going through difficult moments because of loss of jobs. We pray, dear Lord, that you will reach out, provide for their basic needs, give them the encouragement that they need, that they will not feel that the Lord has left them in time of need. We pray for those who are sick and are hospitalized. We pray for your intervention, that even in their moment of sickness, that they will experience the divine presence of the Lord in their midst, that you also administer healing to their bodies and also healing to their emotional parts, that they will be stable emotionally and not be carried out away by the pain of the body that is sick. We also pray for those who have lost loved ones and are going through moments of grief. Dear Lord, we pray for your intervention in their situation, that you wipe their tears, that you encourage them, that you speak words of comfort that cannot be spoken by men, and that even in this time they will experience your divine presence in their midst. We pray for the challenge that we are still facing as a country, the challenge of COVID-19. We pray for your intervention. Ultimately, it is you we look up to for this burden to be lifted up. And dear Lord, we pray that may you be gracious and merciful to us. May you lift up this burden from our country and from the world, that we can walk the path of healing again. We pray for our friends, the medical doctors who are on the front line, helping in the fight against this disease. We pray for your protection upon them. We pray for encouragement. We pray for provision. We pray also for the protection of their loved ones. As they step out every morning and come back in the evening, we pray that you'll protect them and protect their loved ones. And above all, Lord, we pray that you will also grant wisdom and insights to the scientists who are working on this research, that a cure for this disease can be found. We thank you because ultimately we trust in you to provide us with solutions, and we know you are going to do even beyond what we can ask or imagine. And so, dear Lord, we thank you also for the opportunity to listen to your holy word, the word of life, the word that you've given to us, that we can use to instruct and to encourage one another, to sharpen one another as we wait for your second coming. And so as your servant brings your word this morning, we pray, dear Lord, that the word will have an impact in our lives, will help us to correct areas that we need to correct, and even to guide our paths so that our lives here on earth will be fruitful and honoring to you. This is our humble prayer with thanksgiving through Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen. Church, let us turn our Bibles to the reading of God's holy word before we welcome today's speaker. And our reading comes from the book of Judges. Chapter 16, we will read from verse 21 up to 31. The book of Judges, chapter 16, from verse 21 all the way to 31. Let us pay attention to the reading of God's holy word. Then the Philistines seized him, gouged out his eyes, and took him down to Gaza, binding him with bronze shackles. They set him to grinding in the prison. But the hair on his head began to grow again after it had been shaved. Now the rulers of the Philistines assembled to offer a great sacrifice to Dagon, their god, and to celebrate, saying, "Our God has delivered Samson, our enemy, into our hands." When the people saw him, they praised their God, saying, "Our God has delivered our enemy into our hands, the one who laid waste our land and multiplied our slain." Verse 25, while they were in high spirits, they shouted, "Bring out Samson to entertain us." So they called Samson out of prison, and he performed for them. When they stood him among the pillars, Samson said to the servant who held his hand, "Put me where I can feel the pillars that support the temple, so that I may lean against them." Now the temple was crowded with men and women. All the rulers of the Philistines were there. On the roof were about 3,000 men and women watching Samson perform. Then Samson prayed to the Lord, "O sovereign Lord, remember me. O God, please strengthen me just once more, and let me with one blow get revenge on the Philistines for my two eyes." Then Samson reached towards the two central pillars on which the temple stood. Bracing himself against them, his right hand on the one and his left hand on the other, Samson said, "Let me die with the Philistines." Then he pushed with all his might, and down came the temple on the rulers and all the people in it, thus killed many more when he died than while he lived. Verse 31, then his brothers and his father's whole family went down to get him. They brought him back and buried him between Zorah and Eshtaol in the temple of Manoah, his father. He led Israel 20 years. May the Lord bless the reading of his holy word. Now, church, it's time to welcome the Lord's servant who is coming to bring us God's holy word. Our brother, Reverend Matthew Okeo. Allow me to welcome him to come and bring God's holy word. Karibu sana, Reverend.
Good morning, brothers and sisters. It is another good moment that the Lord has given unto us to share the word of the Lord. My name is Reverend Matthew Okeo, and our sign language interpreter is our sister Edith Koros. Feel welcome as we share the word of the Lord. Today, as we have read in the word of the Lord, I want to share with us from this scripture about experiencing God's grace in our failure. Experiencing God's grace in our failure. You know, as human beings, we have gone through many challenges. And I believe no one will say, as a human being, that at no point have they experienced failure in their life. And failure is okay if it will not strike our heart. So this morning, the Lord has laid in our heart that I will be able to share with us that it is possible for us to experience God's grace even in our failure. And from the scripture where we have read Judges chapter 16 from verses 21 to 31, we have the story about our brother Samson. In our study of the Samson life, we have encountered a man who was far less than he should have been. He came into this world born of a promise from God that he would be a Nazarite, set apart for the glory of God, and that he would be the deliverer of the nation of Israel. And if you read all these stories in the book of Judges chapter 13, verses 1 to 14, you will realize that Samson was called to come and judge and to rescue and deliver the children of Israelites from the Philistine. There can be little doubt that the Lord used Samson in his life, but his service to the Lord was hampered by the sins that marred his life. Samson was a man characterized by weakness in his flesh. He had a weakness for wicked women. That desire for illicit sexual relationship continually hindered his usefulness to the Lord. And this made him fall. Eventually, it cost him his freedom. Eventually, this cost him his ministry and even his life. Looking into the life of this man, we see a man who had been deceived by an ungodly woman he had come to love. That is, if you read in verses chapter 16, verses 4, the scripture says here that Samson fell in love with a woman. Sometimes later, he fell in love with a woman in the valley of Cherok, whose name was Delilah. This woman later betrayed him. This woman's nature was Delilah, and she tricked Samson into revealing the source of his strength. His strength was not his own. It came from the Lord. Samson's power was related to his Nazarite's vows. His hair symbolized that vow. When he allowed Delilah to cut his hair, Samson showed contempt for his vows to the Lord. As a result, the Lord removed his hands from his life, and God allowed him to be captured by his enemies. The Philistines tied him. They put him into their prison, put out his eyes and took him into prison, where he was forced to grind. He was forced to do the work that he was not called to do. The mighty judge of Israel was reduced to doing the work of a female slave. That was painful. That was a terrible failure. But the story of Samson does not conclude with his failure. The story of Samson is not concluded by his enemies arresting him. This passage records him experiencing God's grace of forgiveness. Where we have read today, as recorded, Samson experiencing God's grace of forgiveness. These verses remind us that no matter how far we may fall, if we are saved, we are still his. And he has a plan to bring us back to himself. That should be an encouraging news to you and me. It should be an encouraging news to you who have a relationship with our Lord Jesus Christ. Because we all fail. And sometimes, like Samson, we fail in a big way. We all fail the Lord from time to time. And sometimes, we fail in a spectacular fashion. Of course, we see this in the lives of all the heroes of faith mentioned in the Bible. If you read the book of Hebrews chapter 11, it has been known as the hall of the faithful. You could label this also as the hall of the failures, because all the members that are mentioned there failed God in one way or another. Abraham lacked faith to believe God's promises to take care of him, and went down to Egypt where he lied about his wife. And as a man, the father of faith, he failed. Sarah laughed at God and mocked his promises. She failed. Isaac lied about his wife. He failed. Moses committed murder and tried to cover it. Joshua was full of pride and failed to pray before he attacked Ai, where the nations went, which led to the Israelites' nation being defeated. He failed. Not forgetting Rahab was a prostitute. The successful Christian is not the person who never fails, but is the person who, when they fail, get back up and goes on for the Lord. The successful Christian is the person who accepts God's remedy for sin and reach up to God for cleansing and forgiveness when it does fail. That is what these verses are all about. Experiencing God in our failure. Experiencing God's grace in our failure. Remember God's grace. So what is it that we need to look at in order for us to experience God's grace in our failure? One, we must recognize in our failure, we must recognize it is time for restoration. Verses 22, 23. We must recognize it is time for restoration. And as you recognize that, you look at what the scripture says, but the hair on his head began to grow after he had been saved. Verses 22. Scripture says that the hair on his head began to grow again after it had been saved. Samson has to recognize that it is time to be restored. And in recognizing that, you must think about the power in the restoration. The hair of his head began to grow. After time, Samson's hair began to grow. If you remember, his hair was the symbol of the vow to God as a Nazarite. Samson's power did not come from his hair, but it came from his relationship with the Lord. So the growth of his hair was a symbolic of the restoration, was symbolic of the restoration. And he had to understand that, that the symbolic of the restoration of my relationship, of my special relationship of the Lord has begun. So he had to recognize the power in the restoration. Another thing we see there is that you, in the time of restoration, you must look at the picture in the restoration. The picture in the restoration. The regrowth of Samson's heir was a picture of the truth that God was not through with him yet. The grace of God allowed Samson to live long enough for his heir to grow back so that he is able to be restored back to his position. The third thing you look at the restoration is the problem in the restoration. Samson's heir grew back, but it was a slow process. It took some time. The average growth rate of human heir is about 1/8 inch per week. That translates to about 6 inches per year. To grow hair to the waist, about 6 years was needed. That means that Samson was in the process of restoration for a long time. His return did not come an overnight. There is one thing we need to notice concerning this restoration as we look at the power, the picture, and the problem of this restoration is that while sin might be forgiven and the sinner might be made right with God, forgiveness does not cancel out the consequences of our sins. Samson's heirs grew back, but he was still bound. He was still blind. He was still in the prison grinding the grains. Sins leaves a terrible mark on the lives of the guilty. And sins can sometimes destroy us. It can destroy us physically. It can destroy us emotionally. Sin can destroy us mentally or spiritually. And the scars that the sin leaves behind can live for long, whereby your regret, guilt, and loss of peace may stack the guilty part of us that we can feel useless, we can feel helpless. But remember that in the midst of that, God's grace can restore you. You only need to recognize that it is time for restoration. And that is how you will start to experience God's grace in your failure. That time you will not be allowed, you will not continue to focus your eyes on your failure. You will not continue to focus yourself in those who are condemning you, because you have recognized that it is time for me to be restored. Samson could have given up in prison. He could have said, I've lost it. I've missed it. And it could have stayed like that. But he learned. When his heir started to grow, he learned that it is time. He recognized it is time for restoration. And not only recognized it is time for restoration, the next thing that you need to think about, the next thing you need to recognize for you to experience God's grace in your failure is that you must recognize it is time for reproach. It is time for reproach. If you read verses 23 to 25, you will see that there was God's man was being degraded. You know, many of us will fear to be reproached. You will fear to go through that process of people degrading you, people calling you names. So you will choose to stay and accept your situation. For you to experience God's grace in your failure, you must recognize that as I'm being restored, it is also time for me to be under reproach. In these verses, you see God's man was being degraded. Samson was brought into the temple of Dagon. The Dagon was the god of the Philistine. He was portrayed as a half man and a half fish. From his navel down, he was depicted as a fish. From the navel up, he was portrayed as a man. The Philistines were fishermen, and they worshipped Dagon, believing that he would bless their effort to catch more fish. Verses 25 tells us that they brought Samson to his temple to entertain them. They brought Samson in as an entertainer. They brought him in to mock him. They are drunk and they are enjoying looking at him. And they are looking for a good time. They forced Samson to perform like a comedian. One thing they forgot, that they are bringing in a soldier to entertain them. They forgot that this man is a soldier. He's not an entertainer. Why? They no longer fear him as the mighty and defeatable judge of Israel. They no longer see him as a threat to their way of life. They view Samson only as an object of mockery and scorn. They brought him in so that they can laugh at him. Don't you know that Samson felt humiliated? He felt so bad. He was surely feeling as though he is worthless. He was engaged in his sin and he could not see the danger that leaked in his way. Many times you can feel that way. But you must accept to go through this process so that you can understand God's grace in your life and especially in your failure. You remember, sin can transform us, can transform our life to a terrible situation. Sin can take away your dignity. Sin can make you feel as if you are useless. And people can call you names. People can tag you. Even those people who hold you up will no longer want to associate with you. That is what sin can do into your life. But to recognize God's grace in this process, in your failure, you must accept to go through reproach, to go through all that people will say about you. You can't afford to be defensive. You can't afford to rationalize your situation. You can't afford to defend your situation, to give reason why you did whatever you did. You can only accept to go through that in order to experience God's grace in your life. Remember that as you must also be ready that in your sinful situation, God's glory will dimish, will no longer be seen. Not only Samson was degraded, God's glory was gone because Samson was defeated. The Philistine glorified their God. And that's why they were meeting to celebrate the victory that their enemy has been captured. God's name was disgraced. And many times God's name or God's glory will be disgraced if we find ourselves failing immorally, failing in our spiritual life, even economically. God's name will be abused. God's glory will not feature. So you have to accept all that to go through that process in order for you to experience God's grace. Because he is God. Samson was so humiliated. The Philistines were now celebrating the victory because their enemy is under their custody. God's name was defeated because of his failure. But he was ready to face it.
So for us to experience God's grace, we must be ready to go through reproach. And then the third thing that we need to do for us to experience God's grace is not only to recognize the time for restoration and time for reproach, but also we must be able to recognize that it is time for retaliation. It is time to come up and take action. Samson's desire at this time, from verses 26 going onward, says that Samson stands before the people a shell of a man he had been. That was not his desire. Yet, in his darkness, in his humiliation, in his imprisonment, Samson turns his heart towards the Lord. And that's what he said. He prayed for strength. He said in verses 28, going down there, Samson prayed to the Lord, "O sovereign Lord, remember me." That is a very serious prayer. A prayer that was only made by Joseph and the thief on the cross, and Samson here. "Remember me." He turned his heart to the Lord. He realized that, yes, I am here. I'm being humiliated. I'm being looked down upon. Yes, I've failed my God. I've failed in my duty. But the time has come to get back. The time has come for me to retaliate. So he prayed for the strength so that he could get vengeance against those who put out his eyes. Samson asked it in his heart to see the Philistine destroyed, because that is the main reason why God raised him up. That is the main reason why he was called. He remembered his call in his lowest moment. There are times when we all fall into sin. When we do, it is easy to swallow that sin to keep us from seeking God in prayer. Seeking the Lord is the only avenue we have for restoration. We must not allow our guilt over our actions, depressions, or discouragement to keep us away from him. He's the only hope of restoration we have. Therefore, it doesn't matter what kind of thing we have done. We can still go back to him. We must get back to him. We must be honest about our sins, and we must seek his forgiveness. That is why in 1 John chapter 1, verses 9 says that he is faithful. If we confess our sins, he is faithful to forgive. That is our God. That is the gracious God. And that's the grace that we can experience when we have failed. So we must be ready to go back. Let not our situation prevent us from going to God in prayer. Samson could have decided that, no, I have failed God. I have failed in such a way that I cannot speak with God. But remember, he went back and said, "God, remember me. Remember me." It is possible that some here may be harboring some unconfessed sins or unforgiven sin in your life. And you think that everyone around you feel that you're okay, because this is just about you. I want to remind you that you have to be honest with who you are and know that the way I looked at you is not the way God looks at you. The way you look at me is not the way God looks at me. Our God is so gracious and is waiting for us to be honest to ourselves and go back to him. Whatever Samson suffered in the hands of the Philistines was so much bad, was so much horrible. And he caused it because he gave himself to lustful desires. He forgot about his call, but he remembered one thing, that he could go back to God and say, "God, remember me." And God did. God forgave Samson and used him one more time. He also forgave David for his sins and used him again. God also forgave Peter when he denied the Lord. He can do that even to us. He is able and he is faithful. So my friend, my sister, it doesn't matter what you are going through. Remember, it is possible to experience God's grace in your situation, in your condition. Yes, friends may have fled away from you. They might have called you names. But remember, it is possible. He had a desire to change. Samson did not only have a desire, his deeds. Samson took action when those people brought him. Samson asked the young man to help him find a pillar of the building. And the young man did so. And that's when Samson realized that now I need to take action. He told the young man, please just place me there. As wretched as he was, he said, Lord, help me. Lord, remember me. Give me one more chance. Lord, I'm ready to die, but let me die doing your work. Let me die accomplishing what you called me to do. And God granted Samson his desire. Imagine he prayed, Lord, remember me. Please strengthen me just once more. And let me, with one blow, get revenge. And he hold those pillars and he pulled them. And the Lord gave him the victory. And he died serving God. Samson, the mighty judge, died. And the scripture says he killed more people while dying than what he did while living. Thank God his family came and gave him a dignified burial. I don't know the situation you are in right now. I don't know what failure is pulling you down. I don't know what is surrounding you. I only know where I am. And you also know where you are. Please, turn your eyes to the Lord so that you will be able to experience his grace. Chances are that your sins will not lead to the same set of event that marked Samson's life. Chances are that you will fail. Seek the Lord in repentance, and he will forgive you and restore you to usefulness. Where are you in your walk with him? Are you saved? Are you as close as you should be? Are you as close as you used to be? Are you facing a time of testing through temptation? Has God spoken to your heart today? If there's need, please come to him now for help, for forgiveness and restoration that you need. Because he's ready to do that. Let us pray. Lord, thank you for reminding us that we can still experience your grace in our failure. Lord, you know us more than we know ourselves. And I pray that, Lord, you will restore us to what you want us to be. Reach each one of us at the point of our needs. For in Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Thank you very much, Reverend Matthew Keo, for blessing us that we can indeed experience God's grace even during times of failure, that God is never done with us. He's always doing something new. I pray that you are encouraged by this message today. With the situation that you may be in, the struggles that you may be going through, God's grace is there for you. And God is reaching out to you. May the Lord bless you, and thank you again, Reverend, for blessing us. Church, it's now time that we joyfully go to our Lord in worship to give. He's given us everything, more than anything else, just the gift of life. It's our opportunity now to thank him as we give our offerings and as we give our tithes and thanksgiving. Our pay bill number is 809109, and the account, you can give your offering. You can use offering, or you can say, I'm giving tithe or thanksgiving. May the Lord bless you as you give. Now, I want to welcome the Hill Voices to praise the Lord with a number as we give to the Lord. Welcome, Hill Voices.
I can feel the anchor fall.
Thank you very much, Hill Voices, for blessing us. May the Lord bless you as you continue worshiping Him through music and blessing our hearts. Now, church, we're about to end our service, but as we come to the end, I'd like to make one announcement. This is to thank you again for your generosity. This time during the COVID-19, a lot of families have been affected in ways that some cannot afford to put food on their table. The last time we appealed to you, you did a wonderful job. And we are so grateful that the partnership between AIC Milimani and Love Inc. has touched many families. Your partnership is very, very important. Actually, the Love Inc. Group has given AIC Milimani a special food package for us to give to our own members who are suffering. So if you are there and you are a member of AIC Milimani and there is a challenge in putting food on the table, I want to encourage you, please call Pastor Rachel Kishula or call at the office and you'll be assisted. Would love to see that none of us goes through a difficult time alone. We are a church and we need to stand together. And for those of us who would like to help to give more, I want to encourage you, on top of your offering and tithe, please consider giving to the Love Inc. account using the same pay bill number 809109. But there you just, on the account, you say Love Inc. A pack of food that would take somebody for about a week would cost about 1,500. Just 1,500 Kenya shillings. So if you want to do one pack, two packs, or several of them, please, we welcome your donation. And it will reach to the needy people that would deserve the help. So may the Lord bless you indeed for all that you are doing. And now, church, would like now to pray together. And I know probably you are seated on your couch. I want to ask you that we stand so that together we can pray as we bring our service to closure. If that is possible, if you are able to stand, let's pray together. Our Heavenly Father, we are so grateful. Thank you that you are a gracious God. You never leave us. You always reach out to us. And we are so grateful that Jesus, because of you, Lord, our sins are forgiven. And we are so grateful. We realize we are human beings and we need you each day. I pray that each one of us will experience that grace. I want to thank you again, Lord, for your servants who've given their offerings. They have given their tithes to you. They have given their thanksgiving, given to the needy. I pray, Lord, that may your blessings be showered upon each one that has given to you for your ministry and for your mission. I just bless you and thank you for today and for the opportunity to worship together, to just hear your word. And I just now pray, Lord, that as we bring this to an end, that, Lord, you dismiss us with your blessings. We thank you and we bless you, for it's in Christ's name I pray. Amen. Now join me in saying the grace. And now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us now and forevermore. Amen. The Lord bless you and thank you very much. Thank you.
is this? Why are you fighting for bread? What is this? It's bread. And why are you fighting for the bread?
Because it's mine.
It's yours.
Mine.
And it's also yours.
Yes.
Okay. How did you get the bread?
You bought it for me.
And how did you get the bread?
You bought it for me.
Do you know that there's someone who is called the bread of life? Someone who is called the bread. Okay?
Mm-hmm. Who is
now you are fighting for bread. Yeah, who is it? But there's someone called the bread of life. And that person is Jesus Christ. And that's our lesson for today about bread. But before we go to that lesson, children at home and parents, everybody watching, hello, it's so nice to see you. And we want to welcome you to our Sunday lesson today. Do you want to welcome children at home? Wave at them.
Hi, children at home.
Hi, children at home.
Yes, and the children at home want to know this cute kids who came to be with me, even though they are fighting for food, for bread. What's your name, young man?
My name is Jude Kinanji Kimani. Mm-hmm. I am 6 years old.
And what's your name?
My name is Miria Nyambura Kimani. Mm-hmm. I am 8 years old.
I'm so glad to have the two of you. And we also have our friend here, Josh, and their children at home who don't know my name. What's my name?
Pastor Rachel.
Thank you, and I'm so glad to have all of you join us today, okay? And these cute kids here, like I told you last Sunday, we are inviting you to show us your talent, you know, something that you're able to do, okay? Mm-hmm. And so these two kids here, they brought an instrument. And what is the name of your instrument, Jude?
A guitar.
A guitar. And when you, what is this which you play with? A plug. Okay. And what do you have, Mirella?
A recorder.
A recorder. And what song are you playing and singing for us today?
Our God.
Our God is an awesome God. Okay, so let's hear what you have to sing and play. Okay?
And a one and a two and a three. Go.
Okay.
Our God.
Children at home, please clap for them. You know we can't see you, but just let's clap for them, and we can also clap for ourselves here. That was so nice. That was so beautiful. They played the guitar so well, and the flute, and we thank God for that, okay? And Josh, we don't know whether he knows how to play anything, okay? Good. Now, children at home, today we want to introduce something. We want to see whether you guys know your Bible. And we want to learn God's word more. So this section is called Bible Trivia. Say Bible Trivia.
Bible trivia.
Say Bible Trivia.
Bible Trivia.
Yes. So I'm going to be asking you children at home questions. I know parents are watching and guardians. So when we ask the question, the child answers and the parent listens, and then we are going to give the answers also from here. Okay? So the first question to all of you, and Jude, you will answer this one for me. What is the name of the book where we read God's word?
The Bible.
The Bible. Children at home, did you get that? Okay. Riel?
Yes.
The Bible is divided into how many parts?
Two parts.
Okay. And what are the names of these divisions?
Old Testament
and New Testament.
Testament means promise.
Oh my. Please repeat again. What did you say? How many parts is the Bible divided to?
Old Testament and New Testament. Testament means promise.
Testament means promise. So there are promises in the Old and the New Testament. Thank you so much, Jude. You're so sweet. And so, how many books are there in the Old Testament, Miriel?
The Old Testament has 39.
39 books, and the New Testament?
27.
So in total, the Old and the New Testament has how many books? Children at home? Did you get it? 66. How many of them?
66.
Wonderful. Now, in the New Testament, there are the first four books. Do you know their names?
Yes.
It's what?
Matthew,
Mark,
Luke,
and John.
Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. Those four books are called what?
The Gospels.
Mirella, wow! I didn't know you know the answer. The Gospels, they are called the Gospels. And you know what Gospel means, Jude? Good news. It means what?
Good news.
So it records everything that Jesus did. The good news of our Lord Jesus Christ, okay? Yes. Now, in that four books of the Bible, there are many stories of people who were very close to Jesus. And they spent a lot of time with them. What was their name?
The disciples.
The disciples. And how many were they?
12 of them.
12 of them. Any name of the disciple? Any that you know?
Philip.
Thomas. Judas.
Peter.
John.
And there was one disciple who was not very good and he did something bad to Jesus. What was his name?
Judas.
So that means you can also have good friends and bad friends. And these people spend a lot of time with Jesus. Okay? Good. So did you hear those questions? Next Sunday, we will have others just to help us know our Bible better. Now, like I promised you last Sunday, okay? We are learning something new. We are introducing a new lesson. But before we introduce a new theme, tell me what we learned last Sunday, Jude.
We learned
what was the topic, first of all?
We learned about the Red Sea.
What about the Red Sea? What was the topic, Mirella?
The topic was about the Red Sea.
Crossing the Red Sea. And what happened, Jude?
Okay, let me tell you the story.
Tell me, I'm listening.
Once upon a time, there were Israelites.
Yes.
They were walking. Then soon they end up.
They were walking from where?
From
town to home.
No.
From where?
From Egypt.
To the Red Sea. And then what happened when they got to the Red Sea, Jude?
The people said, How are we gonna pass
this Red Sea? So Mirella, what happened next?
Then after that, God told Moses to stretch out his hand.
How? Show me. Like how? And what happened?
The sea was divided
into two.
And
one sea over here
and the other
sea over here.
Okay, not one sea. It's some water this side and some water the other side. And in the middle there was what? Dry land. So what did the Israelites do? They walked.
They walked. And behind the Israelites, were the Egyptians.
Were they good people?
Pharaoh and his army.
What did they want to do to the children?
They want to kill. Then the wheels of the
chariot
it sunk
stuck into the sand. Yes,
then
and then
Pharaoh's army they ran. Then after the Israelites crossed the sea,
God told
Mirella, Mirella tell us now.
God told Moses to stretch out his hand.
Again?
Then the water came together.
And
then
what happened to the Egyptians?
Pharaoh and his army drowned.
They all drowned. And they did what? They
died.
And the children of Israel were safe and God delivered them. And they continued with their journey. And we saw how God is powerful. Okay? Memory verse. Children here, you say the memory verse, and children at top. But I begin with you here. What was the memory verse?
Joshua chapter 1 verse 9.
It says,
have I not commanded you? Be strong and courageous.
You do it so well. Hey, I want to see that again. Please do the memory verse again when you are seated.
Joshua chapter 1 verse 9. It says, have I not commanded you? Be strong and courageous.
And there are also children at home who are listening and they have sent me memory verses. So children here, please pay attention. Ebu, hold your ear like this when you're listening. Let's listen to the children at home.
My name is Liban Kipruto and I'm 6 years old.
My name is Ethan Kiprono and I'm 9 years old. We want to say a memory verse.
Joshua chapter 1 verse 9. Have I not commanded you? Be strong and courageous. Joshua chapter 1 verse 9.
Hello, church. This is Perez Dalai. I am 9 years old. I have memory verse and a song. Joshua chapter 1 verse 9, he says, have I not commanded you? Be strong and courageous. Do not be afraid. Heavenly Father, you are wonderful. You are marvelous. You are excellent. We worship you, Lord, because you're wonderful. And you let us sing our song.
Hi, I'm Imanda and I'm 7 years old.
Hi, I'm Bella and I'm 4 years old.
The memory verse is Joshua chapter 1 verse 9. It says, have I not commanded you? Be strong and courageous. God bless you and have a good week.
Thank you so much, children at home. You have been listening and following. Thank you, parents, for teaching the children memory verses. Continue sending them to us. Now, we are going back to our lesson today. For the next weeks, we are going to be talking about things that Jesus said about himself. Jude,
yes?
If I just met you on the road and I have never seen you before, how will I know your name?
You have to introduce yourself.
Yes.
Hi, my name is Jude Kinanji Kimani.
Wow.
Then you'll know my name.
Then I will know your name. So in the next weeks, Jesus is going to introduce himself to us children. Jude, you have said it so well. Wow. You are very nice kids. We are going to learn how Jesus told us about himself. So our theme for the next few weeks is the seven I ams of Jesus. Say the seven I ams.
The seven I ams.
Of who? Jesus.
Of Jesus.
And all these I ams are from one book, one of the Gospels, the book of John. He is going to tell us who he is. Because unless he tells us who he is, we are not able to know him. And so for today, Jesus is telling us that I am the what?
The bread of life.
Even though you have fought for the bread and it is broken, just like Jesus was broken on the cross. Jesus is the bread of life. Our lesson is, Jesus is the bread of life. And you know what happened? We already said that Jesus had disciples, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
And these disciples, they had stayed with him for a very long time. Mm-hmm. But kumbe, they did not know him. Say kumbe.
Kumbe.
You know when you say kumbe, it is alas. Kumbe, they did not know Jesus.
Kumbe.
So you know, one day as they were talking with Jesus, they asked him something. And you know, where do we read about Jesus? What did we say? Where do we read about Jesus and what he did? From the Bible. And we want to read what the disciples of Jesus asked him, so that he tells them about bread and all that. And I am reading from John chapter 6. John chapter
6.
Are we together? Are you listening to me, children at home? And children with me? John chapter 6. Listen. They asked him, chapter 6 verse 32. 35, okay? So they asked him, these are the disciples, what sign then will you give us that we may see and believe you? What will you do? Our ancestors ate the manna in the wilderness, and manna is bread. As it is written, he gave them bread from heaven to eat. Listen to what Jesus told them. He said to them, very truly I tell you, it is not Moses who has given you the bread from heaven, but it is my Father who gives the true bread from heaven, that comes down from heaven and gives life to the world. Sir, they said, always give us this bread. Then Jesus declared, I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never go hungry, and whoever believes in me will never be thirsty. So the disciples of Jesus did not know Jesus, and they told him, you know, in the Old Testament times, and we know the story of Israel, God gave them manna. Manna is bread. But they said, Moses gave us manna. They thought it was Moses. Jesus told them, no, it wasn't Moses. It is that bread which came from my Father from heaven. And the disciples asked him, so can you do something to us? Show us a sign.
Okay.
So that we know who you are.
Mm-hmm.
And then we can believe you. And Jesus tells them, I am the bread of life. So they are wondering, you are the bread of life. Do you think they understood?
No.
They were not understanding.
No,
and children, do you understand?
No.
Yeah. When Jesus says he is the bread of life, does he, is Jesus this? Can you eat Jesus? Is he
no.
here?
No. Because he have a small mouth.
We have a small mouth and Jesus is...
He's really tall.
He thinks Jesus is really tall and his small mouth cannot even, you can't even fit this.
Yeah.
But he says Jesus is the bread of life. And what he means when he is saying this and he tells them, he says, whoever comes to me will never go hungry. Okay? Mm-hmm. Jesus is our spiritual food. Why do we eat bread? First of all, do you like bread?
Yes. Because why? It's so smooth and...
So and sweet. And how does it smell?
So good. It looks like wheat.
Like wheat. Why do you like bread?
Because of its color,
mm-hmm.
and you can add jam of on it.
And it tastes nice. And when you eat it, what happens? Do you feel hungry?
No.
Just like Jesus is saying, Jude, when we eat him. So Jesus is our spiritual food, okay? Mm-hmm. When we feed on Jesus. But she said, our mouths are small and Jesus is big. So how do we eat God? Jesus, how can we? Is that possible?
Mm-hmm. By reading the Bible.
By reading the Bible, because we began by saying the Bible is God's word. And in John chapter 1, verse 1, he says, in the beginning was the word, and the word was God, and the word is me. Jesus Christ is the word. So when we eat him, when we are reading the word, it's like we are eating Jesus, the bread. And it is sweet, and it makes us full. So today, children, we are learning that Jesus is telling us he is the bread of life. When we feed on his word, we are full, okay? And we said we feed on his word by reading his word. For example, when we read God's word, the things you have heard, what does the word of God tell you, Jude?
Be obedient.
Be obedient. That is eating God's word. Okay, Miriela, what does the Bible tell us?
Following the Ten Commandments.
And what are some of these commandments?
Honor your father and mother.
Goodness, yes.
Do not worship other gods.
Wow. Do not steal.
Do not steal. Do not lie. Honor your father and mother.
Do not murder. Hey, Miriela, you have really eaten God's word together with Jude. Do you hear how these children have eaten God's word? Children, that's what we are learning. They have read God's word and memorized it. It is in their hearts. And so they know that God tells them to obey their parents. And they just do that. So Jesus becomes their bread of life. Wow. This is such a wonderful lesson today. It is so real, Jude. When you read God's word, you obey what it says, then it's like you're feeding on Jesus Christ himself. Children at home, I pray that you can love God's word. Because if you read it, it is so sweet. And you obey it, you live a good life. You see, the way me, I am big like this. You know, I was a young child like you. I started going to Sunday school when I was small. And I was taught God's word. And I grew with that word until I am now big. And that is what your parents are doing when they are teaching you. You grow in God's word, okay? But now let me ask you. Do you read God's word, children?
No.
No.
You don't read God's word. That is what we are learning today. Do not feel sorry. That is why we have that lesson today. Because from now henceforth, we want to be reading God's word. Because when we read God's word, we are eating the spiritual bread. We are eating Jesus Christ. And I want to teach you very simply how to read God's word. When we want to read God's word, we have our special time, okay? You don't start reading God's word and you are watching TV. You are watching cartoons, then you pick the Bible, no? You are sleeping in bed, you pick the Bible. You set your time. You sit where you know you are serious. And of course, you'll be doing it with parents at home and we are asking for your help. Please get a Bible for your child. Set just very few minutes, like 10 minutes for children. Not more than 10 minutes to read God's word. And for this week, I want us to read, all children will be reading Psalm. You know the book of Psalm?
Mm-hmm.
Yep. Psalm chapter 1, verse 1 to 6. 6 verses for 1 week. So you can just pick one verse. Parents and children at home, I want you to be reading only one verse per day. For example, today is Sunday. So the verse for today is Psalm 1, verse 1. Let me read for you, and then you can listen to what these children are learning from. Because we want to be reading. And I want the children to be reading along with the parents, okay? So you sit like I am sitting with them, and you read together God's word like this. Blessed is the one who does not walk in step with the wicked, or stand in the way that sinners take, or sit in the company of mockers. Just one verse a day. What does that verse say to you, Miriela?
It means to me obedience.
It means to her obedience. What does it say to you?
Honor your parents.
Honor your parents, but also don't mix with people who are sinners, who mock Jesus. How can people mock Jesus and God?
Huh?
Mm-hmm. How can they say bad things about God?
Because
they have
God
not yet.
Is the mightiest God.
So how can they say something bad about the mightiest God?
Because they have not read the Bible.
They've not read the Bible. So these are the children who abuse others. Have you seen children like this? Yeah? Who like fighting? So God is telling us this week, as we have just read, do not be with people like that. And that's what we will be doing, children. Every day you read a verse, Psalm 1 to 6. And this is what I want you to do, children at home. When you read those verses with your parents, please tell your parents to send me an SMS, you know, a text, and tell them what you have learned, which verse you have read, and what that verse has said to you, like they have just told me. That is how we read God's word. That is how we eat Jesus, who is the bread of life. That is how we'll be eating Jesus and his word. We read one verse a day. We meditate. When you say meditating, it's just listening to what God is saying, and then you send to me the verse and what it says to you. And I'll be reading all of them, what God has spoken to you. Jesus is the bread of life. That is our lesson that we have learned today. And now we want to do the memory verse, still from the same chapter. So children, here with me, say memory verse.
Memory verse.
John chapter 6.
John chapter 6.
Verse 35.
Verse 35.
Then Jesus declared.
Then Jesus declared.
I am the bread of life.
I am the bread of life.
Whoever comes to me.
Whoever comes to me.
Will never go hungry.
Will never go hungry.
Okay, let us do it again. John chapter 6 verse 35.
John chapter 6 verse 35.
It says. Then Jesus declared.
Then Jesus declared.
I am the bread of life.
I am the bread of life.
Whoever comes to me.
Whoever comes to me.
Will never go hungry. So as usual, children at home, memorize the verse and send a nice video. Please, when you do the video, do with a nice background, parents. And let the children speak nicely and, you know, with a loud voice. And send the verses early before Wednesday of this week. Okay?
Yeah.
And we will be reading them here and listening to them. Now, last Sunday, I reminded you that we will be giving offerings. Why do we give offerings?
Because.
Mm-hmm. Is God too poor?
No, because for the pastor to get the money, to go and give it to the poor.
To support. My goodness. For the pastor. So he knows that when we are giving offerings, we are giving offering to the church. And we are giving so that we can support God's work. We support the poor. We do other things, okay? So, Miriela.
Tell you why we give the offerings to say thank you to God.
Wow, to say thank you to God. And why do we say thank you to God?
Because he's our father from heaven, and he's marvelous.
And he has given us life. He is the one who has given us that money, first of all.
And
he has created us. So when we are giving offering, we are saying thank you to him. Did you know that, children? So now it is that time to give. And how do we give now? We are here, you are at home. Miriela, do you throw the money here? Oh, I mean, now are we supposed to give?
No.
Okay, Miriela.
You send from Safaricom, I think.
Yes. Church, you sent to our church pay bill number. And what is our church pay bill number?
809-109
pay bill. And the account number is?
Sunday school.
So please, let's do it now, children. That's what we are doing. We are giving our offerings through the church pay bill number. Parents, help the children. The church pay bill number is 809-109. And the account number is Sunday school. And children, always remember to remind your parents every Sunday to prepare their offering so that we can give to the Lord. Thank you so much for giving. This has been a wonderful Sunday school.
Yep.
But I am not very happy. You know why I am not very happy?
No.
Next Sunday we are celebrating birthdays for July children. Nobody has sent me, Jude. So can we celebrate your birthday again?
No.
Your birthday is in which month?
May.
Yours is in?
June.
Mine is in August. So we can celebrate, but we want to celebrate your birthdays for July. Please, children, please, parents, send me a photo of your child and the name for all July children. And next Sunday, we will sing for them happy birthday and throw balloons, and it's going to be nice, okay? So we want to thank God for the wonderful lesson. And before we finish, Josh is here. Thank you so much for being with us. We want to pray. And today, why do we pray, children? Tell me. Why do we pray?
To praise God.
Okay. We praise God when we are praying. Why do we pray again?
To make the diseases to go.
Okay. So that He can make the diseases to go. So today, what do you want us to pray for?
For our teachers, mm-hmm. our Sunday school and teachers, our friends, the poor to have a lot of money to stay in a new house.
Just God to provide for them, okay, Jude? Miriela, what do you want us to pray for today?
For the coronavirus to go.
For coronavirus to go. So today the two of you are praying, okay? We start with you, Jude. Just pray kidogo, and then Miriela is going to finish, and that will be the end. So, Jude, we are praying. And how do we usually pray? What did we teach you in our Sunday school? How do we pray?
When I want to pray, mm-hmm. I put your hands together. I close my eyes. I bow my head. Then I start praying.
You forgot. You have tried, but everybody forgot at home. Let's remind them again. When I want to pray, let's start.
When I want to pray, I put my hands together. I bow my head, I close my eyes, then I pray.
Jude?
Our Heavenly Father, we come before you this afternoon. Bless me and Nyambura, be good children. Mm. Bless Pastor Rocha, she has a lot of money. Bless me and Nyambura, be good children. Mm. Tomorrow on our Zoom, bless the poor to have a lot of money to build the new house. Mm. Bless this COVID-19 as it goes. In Jesus' name I pray.
Amen. Miriela, pray for something.
Let's bow our heads and pray. Mm. Our Father, thank you for this sacrifice. Thank you for parents, teachers, pastors, and friends. I hope this coronavirus may go. Mm. Let the people who are sick to be well in Jesus' name.
Amen. And their children at home and you might want to give their lives to Jesus so that they know Him and experience the bread which is so sweet. And I want to pray for those ones, okay? Say this after me for the children at home and you if you want to get saved. Lord Jesus.
Lord Jesus.
I give my life to you.
I give my life to you.
Please forgive me.
Please forgive me.
And make me your child.
And make me your child.
Thank you for saving me.
Thank you for saving me.
In Jesus' name we pray.
In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
Amen.
Parents, help those children at home who have given their lives to Christ. Pray with them. If you need help, you can reach out to me and we continue walking together. Thank you so much, Josh. Thank you so much, Jude. You have made our Sunday school beautiful. Thank you so much, Miriela. And I want to appreciate all the Sunday school teachers, especially Sally and teacher Josiah. You have seen the singing and dancing which our children are doing. They have done all that. And we want to thank God for them, okay? And we want to wish you a beautiful week. Please stay safe. Take care of yourself. We love you so much. Today we have learned about the bread of life. Next week we will learn something else about Jesus. Okay? So from here, what should we say to the children at home?
Bye. Keep safe from this virus.
From this virus. And you wanted us to say the grace?
Yeah.
Okay, say the grace then.
May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ. And the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us now and forevermore. Amen.
Amen. Amen, amen. God bless you. Have a good week. Let's say goodbye.
Goodbye, children.